Right. Hello, everyone. You hear me all right?
Yes, we hear you fine.
So, just trying to get this thing to advance. So, when it comes to environmental policy and action, and in general, more and more people are turning to evidence-based approaches. I believe that environmental policies are still very strongly influenced by myths, popular myths. And I think that forests are right on the top of the list of myth-making, especially in Europe and North America, which are very influential, of course, because they have money. So before grave mistakes are made by planting billions of trees, I think it's time to start myth-busting common forest beliefs. This is a little bit tongue-in-cheek, but I hope that it'll stimulate you to think about these things a bit more. So the process I'll follow will be to talk about a few common myths. I'm not going to tell you the origin of the myths or why I think they are myths. I'm just going to present them. I'm going to test them. Inspired by that American TV program, Mythbusters. I'm afraid I'm not nearly as entertaining, but I'll do my best. And I'll test the myths, and the results will be given as busted, confirmed, I don't think there are any of those, and uncertain because it depends, or the test is lousy. So if a myth is busted, the question mark would be, are the methods appropriate when you try and test a myth? Is a scale appropriate? Can the results be generalized? That's what you need to know for scale. And often not, because the methods are intrinsically local or because they're located in a particular time. And the problems of generalizing across space and time very often. But I think that's interesting and instructive in itself, because it suggests that policies and action based on forest myths also need to be sensitive to space and to time. And too often there's just one solution blanketly applied because the policies are inflexible. So my heroes as Mythbusters are two British anthropologists, Fairhead and Leach. And I think they were the first out there playing forest myth-busting games. And they tested the idea that forests are ancient and that the non-forests are the leftovers after deforestation. And they worked in West Africa. There's several examples. This is the particular example I'm going to talk about, Kisidugu in Guinea. And it's a degraded landscape to many European visitors, largely savannas. Very open, very few trees. After fires, it looks very degraded for those people not used to grass fires. And these little patches here, these little pimple-like things, are patches of forest around the villages. This is a closer look. There's a village and a patch of forest around it. And this is more or less, I couldn't get a picture from the ground level, but this is the sort of thing you might expect, that savannas changing abruptly to a patch of forest. So the myth here is that the landscape was covered with tropical forest, and that people, through their burning and shifting cultivation, have destroyed that forest, promoted the conversion to savannas, and resultant severe degradation. So when they set out there to actually talk to people and find out whether there was evidence for the story, they found that the villagers told a different story. And they said that the region had always been savannas. And in fact, the villagers said they had planted the forests to help protect the villagers from fires and to use in various ways, including for resources. So the methods by which Fairhead and Leach tested the myth is these interviews, mostly with elderly villagers from many villages, at least 40 villages in the area. Then they went to check up on the stories using aerial photographs, which we all should be able to do. And they found the earliest ones from the early 1950s. And then they went further than that and looked for historical archives from early in the 20th century, from French colonial sources, and from way back, I think almost into the 18th century, from European explorers, all of whom reported that this area was a savanna, not a forest. In their conclusion, this myth is busted. These forests are not ancient, they're brand new, and they were built by the villagers within the 20th century. And I strongly recommend you go and have a look at their YouTube video called Second Nature. And this book, Misreading the African Landscape, is excruciating for ecologists to read because it really challenges the lack of rigor that we've used in trying to define deforestation, where massive deforestation over very brief time periods is merely because of things like changing the definition of what is a forest. Just get it. What it goes on here. So here's my first real myth that I want to test, and that is that oxygen comes from trees, and cutting down forests will deprive us of air to breathe. Trees and forests are therefore fundamental to human existence, and if we were to remove the Amazon, for example, people wouldn't be able to breathe. And this was quite prominent fires burning in Brazil, and people, the newspapers were coming up with these stories. So the tests, I'm just going to give two tests, one of which is the advent of Marlies, and it's based on ecosystem ecology, and the other one is a paleoecological text. So here's Yadvinda's blog. It's an excellent blog, and you should go and look this up. Does the Amazon provide 20% of oxygen? And what he did was to take a systems ecological approach and look at the amount of oxygen produced in the process of photosynthesis, and then consider all the ways in which that oxygen is used for respiration from leaves, from the branches, from the roots of the plants, from microbial respiration, from the decomposition of wood, from decomposition of litterfall, and so on. And the conclusion he came to is that the net contribution of the Amazon ecosystem to the world's oxygen is effectively zero. And the same would be pretty much true of any ecosystem on Earth, at least on timescales relevant to human beings. Atmospheric oxygen is not constantly replenished by our ecosystems. The atmospheric oxygen is ancient. So the myth is busted. But it's quite fun to consider paleo tests and just ask the question, what was the oxygen content of the atmosphere before forests? Unfortunately, measuring ancient atmospheric oxygen is tricky. And if you're looking for research opportunities and you're really good and interested in geochemistry, this is definitely a place to go and see what's possible. So far, atmospheric oxygen is basically produced or imagined through the use of geochemical models. But we do have a potential way of measuring ancient oxygen by looking for the presence of ancient charcoal. Then you can ask the question, how much oxygen do you need for vegetation fires in the past? And how much oxygen do we need to survive? And then you can ask the question, when did vegetation start burning, and link it to the oxygen in the atmosphere. And then you can say, well, when did tropical forests first appear? Did we only get enough oxygen to burn when the forests appeared? So this is the first test of what are the oxygen requirements to get vegetation fires. And this is brilliant work by Claire Belcher, and showing at the top there how oxygen content changes. And this is the probability of burning. And it's extremely low. This is to get fires to spread through a bed of sphagnum. is extremely low until about 19.5%, when there's suddenly a threshold oxygen is reached, and from then onwards, any increase in oxygen and the fires do spread. Well, interestingly enough, our current atmosphere sits at about 21% oxygen. Fire needs about 19.5% oxygen for it to spread, according to these results, and humans need the same for levels of oxygen to live. They also need about 19.5%. So if we can see ancient fires, we can be pretty convinced that we could, if we were living then, we could have survived. So here's a trace of ancient oxygen by Andrew Scott and Glasspool, putting together all the information they could find on charcoal in ancient coals. And this is their trace of oxygen through time. And basically the first fires go back at least 400 million years. There's our current oxygen levels. And you'll see that the... Sorry, there's somebody, if you can hear my talking, I'll carry on. Okay. There's been enough oxygen for wildfires for at least 400 million years. And that is 100 million years before conifer forest and 350 million years before tropical forest first appeared. So from this evidence is also, we don't need forests to make oxygen. This myth is busted. Throw it away. If you see the newspapers, you know that they're talking nonsense. The next myth, a very persistent myth, and this is that forests make rain. And if you want to make the world moister, go and plant some trees. So here's two interesting newspaper articles that I picked up. This one from Australia, saying, when trees make rain, could restoring forests help ease the drought in Australia? And about the same time, there was this article in a Cape Town newspaper, breaking down the myth that planting forests could help drought regions. And if you read both these articles, both of them say, planting forests will not get rid of drought. In fact, it might exacerbate the drought. So can we plant forests to improve water supply by making the climate wetter? Well, this was very prominent an idea in Cape Town during the period of 2015 to 2018, when we had a severe drought. And the city came up with this sort of catchphrase, day zero, the day where you turn the tap on and nothing would come out. And that really got the citizens to respond. Basically, the city had outrun its water supply as the urban population grew. So there was lots of debate about how we could increase the water supply, especially by, for example, managing land cover in the sources of our water, the catchments. And just to say, this is not a new question at all. It was a major issue about 100 years ago after big droughts in the 1920s. Society was deeply divided. The people living in cities said, plant forests. If you plant forests in the mountains, the high rainfall areas, that would increase water supply. The farmers who use the rivers most directly for irrigation and for the crops and for their livestock said, not at all. You plant pine plantations, conifer plantations, as forestry had been doing, and you'll dry up the rivers, directly contradicting. So the forestry department at the time set up paired catchment experiments starting in 1938. And these catchment experiments, the one catchment is left with a native vegetation, fynbos, I'll show you a picture in a moment. And then adjacent to it would be an experimental catchment where trees were planted after an initial period of calibration of as much as 10 years or more. This is the site of the first experiments, the Yonkershoek Valley looking down there, and this is the native vegetation, sparse, shrubby heathland. In the distance, you can see what happened when you plant trees? And then the question is, does that make this valley moister, or are the farmers right and it makes it drier? And down the bottom there, you'll see the bits of a town which depends on this water. This experiment, by the way, is still continuing, and I believe it's the longest running continuous hydrological experiment in the world, but it's always dangerous to say it's the only one and the first and so on. And here are the results. Anything below this zero line means that the forestry plantations use more water and less came out into the streams than the control, the ordinary unforested shrubland. And what you see for both of these examples, different catchments, where the forest started, were initiated at different times, a major loss of water to the streams. Trees demand more water than grasses and shrubs, so planting trees dries up the stream flow. That's the conclusion one has to come to here. So one could say the myth is busted, and a lot of policy in South Africa has been based on this experiment, contradicting a lot of propaganda saying that plant trees and you get more water. So is the myth really busted, or does the answer depend on scale? And there's a vociferous group of climatologists primarily who argue that planting trees does increase the humidity, the rain in an area. And here's their argument. The sun causes the evaporation of water. It goes up in the clouds, starts moving over land, dumps down on trees on a forest patch. The forest evapotranspire water, it goes up again, gets carried further, and that moisture is redeposited as rain. The trees then evapotranspire that, and it can get retranspired again. So they argue that forests are the best at this recycling of moisture, so that land cover influences the number of times a rainfall drop feeds in from the ocean onto land. And they say it recycles an average of 2.6 times as rain before returning to the ocean. But the number of times it is recycled depends on land cover, climate, topography, and the scale of land cover change. So the arguments are supported by models. The problem is how you test it. But it does come up with the attractive idea that plants create their own climate by changing the supply of rain. So in contrast to the demand side of things, where trees demand more moisture, they can also supply more. And which process is most important in contributing to moisture in the streams? So how do you test the supply versus demand? And the test of the supply side effects clearly needs a large scale land use change. And this idea, incidentally, is the idea behind the green wall that's supposed to be stopping the Sahara. By recycling rain. Well, will it do that, or will it actually behave like the mountain catchment experiments and dry up all the streams along the Sahel? How do we know? Now, I found this paper, which is a useful review, comparing the hydrological responses, because these are hydrologists, in small versus large catchments. A large watershed of more than 1,000 square kilometers compared with a small watershed of less than 1,000. So let's just look at the large watersheds first. And this axis indicates changes in forest cover. So this is where people have chopped down forests. And this is the response in terms of annual runoff. And you see, if you get rid of forests, annual runoff increases. So get rid of trees and you have more moisture in large watersheds. If you add trees, the results clearly show that you'll get less runoff, your streams will dry up. So this apparently supports the demand side of things, saying that trees dry up rivers. They don't add more rain. And therefore, that rain getting into the rivers and streams, which people can then use. If you look at the small watersheds here, we'll just go through it quickly, notice the change of scale. This thing here, this experiment here, resulted in a 600% increase in runoff when they removed trees. So here we have only 60%. This is an order of magnitude higher. But what this is, what really showing is that like the large watersheds, the small watersheds remove the trees and you'll get more rain appearing in the rivers. Add trees, however, and they said that the data appears to show no consistent change. So it can sometimes be an increase, it's sometimes a decrease. So what do you say? Has the myth been busted? My own feeling is this rainfall recycling issue requires some clever test. And I know that in the Amazon, people have argued strongly that if the Amazon was to go, the recycling of rain would disappear and the whole region would dry up substantially. And that partly depends on the topography and the climatic context. I found this a very interesting paper looking at the history of these arguments about forests and water. And these guys say that supply side management policies, in other words, plant trees and make the climate wetter, in history that should elicit caution. Demand side policies, plant trees and you'll dry up the rivers because trees won't need more moisture, are based on almost a century of hydrological research and should not be overturned quickly in regions that face potential water scarcity before more research is conducted. So I think the balance is on planting trees to dry things up. I don't know how this would work in the UK or in countries in the north where drought is rare or when the form of precipitation is in snow. But this myth is certainly broken, if not completely busted. Myth number four, the biggest store of terrestrial carbon is in tropical forests. And there are various implications of this. Certainly you should, it implies prioritizing preservation of forests, especially in the tropics. And secondly, to target tree planting in the tropics to try and reduce CO2 in the atmosphere because you can store carbon more quickly. And here's some data just to support the argument. This is total terrestrial plant carbon estimated as 450 petagrams, forests accounting for 80% of that, 360 petagrams. North temperate boreal forests account for 80 petagrams of that, and tropical forests are accounting for nearly half, basically half of terrestrial carbon is sitting in tropical forests, which is a large amount. It's amazing what you can do now with remote sensing. And this is an example from the Northern Hemisphere showing woody biomass. And you can see that the most plant biomass, woody biomass, is in the southern warmer regions. And carbon declines as you go north. In other words, if you're trees, which is quite reasonable. So, but what you see here are the estimates of the total amount of carbon stored in these northern woody systems. And because the boreal forests in the taiga are so extensive, they still account for nearly half of the woody biomass, of the total carbon stored in plants in the northern hemisphere. What these analyses are leaving out, however, is the soil. By far the biggest store of terrestrial carbon is in the soil. 1,500 petagrams of carbon estimate. So what's that? More than three times greater than the total plant biomass. Here's a map of where that carbon is distributed. Much harder to do because satellites don't read soil carbon. And what you see here is an inverse pattern to the tropical forest, where most of the carbon is stored right up in the north in the peatlands, and the tropics have much less soil carbon. And just to contrast that with above and below ground plant biomass, ignoring soils, and you can see the clear emphasis in tropical forests is well placed. But should we not also be considering the soil carbon and what's going on there? When you look at a tree, you might be impressed by its bulk, like you'd be impressed by the bulk of an iceberg. But we all know that a lot of the iceberg, more of it, is below ground than above. And I'd suggest it's the same in these northern systems, where you ignore the below ground iceberg component of the soil carbon at your peril. And even this is underestimated because it only went to 1 meter. And a recent study shows how much soil carbon is really stored in these boreal zones by going down to 3 meters. And this is under permafrost. Huge amounts of carbon, massive amounts of carbon, dwarfing the tropical forest contribution to global carbon stores. So most of the world's carbon is actually in boreal peatlands. And one estimate puts the soil organic carbon at around 1,300 petagrams of carbon. What's nerve-wracking for me is that this permafrost carbon is threatened with release due to global warming. And I see lots and lots of media stories covering fires in the Amazon and in the tropics. But I have to look really hard to see the stories about threats to the permafrost from Northern Hemisphere burning and Northern Hemisphere global warming. But if this soil carbon was released, our atmospheric CO2 would increase by more than 600 parts per million. We would be really in trouble. So where is the political action on this? Where's the IUCN? Where's the bond challenge? Why is there so much emphasis on tree planting in the tropics rather than on sorting out and trying to really put effort into preserving the carbon that's stored in the massive soils, the peatland soils at the north? So look at that. There's tropical forest, 225 versus boreal soil carbon of at least 1,300. And if the Amazon and all the tropical forests were to burn, that is a change that we'd get from our current concentrations of CO2 due to the release of all that carbon stored. This is what would happen if those boreal peatlands start burning. We'd be up to 1,000 parts per million. That is terrifying. So, you know, I wish people would start thinking about these and working far harder and get the public involved. Forget planting trees, go and plant peatlands. So is the biggest source of terrestrial carbon in tropical forests? No, this myth is busted. It's sitting in soil carbon. This is the last myth that I want to talk about in any sort of detail, and that's that forests are somehow linked to biodiversity and equate with biodiversity. And you should plant forests to promote or restore biodiversity. And it's a tricky thing to test. What scale do we test it at? With which organisms? And where? Because the results could vary depending on where you are. So this is an open, non-forested landscape in the Cape, in South Africa. And it burns, and people might consider it degraded and deforested and in need of forest landscape Okay, so I was making the point that this is the most diverse temperate flora in the world, comparable to closed tropical forests in the number of species. Here's just one example of the diversity in the Proteaceae, some 330 species, nearly all of which are endemic to the region. And so it goes on. It's an absolute headache to try and learn all of this flora. If we go to the tropics, this is in Brazil. And again, you might be tempted to go and plant trees and to try and boost biodiversity in a situation like this. And my colleagues have done this sort of thing. They've compared, there is pressure to convert the Brazilian savannas, the Cerrado, from this to something like this by planting trees, except it won't be as diverse as this. It'll typically be planting of eucalypts. And there's this nice paper showing at a local level, at an alpha diversity level, what happens as you increase carbon stocks, the amount of trees. And there's a steep decline in plant diversity. And that decline is most steep with the savanna species, the sun-loving species, but it influences all of the plants. The total plants diversity declines when you add more trees to this landscape. And here's similar data showing the steep decline in ant diversity. So they're ants that are specialized for being in the sunlight. And the more trees there are, those ants disappear. So going from here to here along this gradient of increasing tree cover, it's a change in species. And when you go into forests, you're losing the species of the open habitat. There's this nice study by that recently came out comparing species numbers in different tropical regions, pan-tropical, afrotropical, neotropical, the South America and so on, Indo-Malayan and Australasian. And these are the total species counts for mammals. And this is in the forest and this is in the open grassy systems. And what surprised me was how similar they were. I would have expected more vertebrate diversity in the forests than the savannas, because there's more vertical structure, creating more niches for animals to exploit. This is particularly the case for birds. And yet the total richness of birds is very similar in open habitat versus forests. So that implies tremendous turnover of species in these forests, in the grassy biomes, which must contribute to their species richness compared to forests. The amphibians definitely do better in the forests, and the vascular plants undoubtedly do far better in forests than in grasslands, which is not surprising because after all, they are grassy. They just are fewer tree species. However, these authors went on and said, we all know that species tend to increase in the tropics as it gets wetter. And savannas tend to be in the drier end of the scale. So is this just not a biased thing linked to rainfall? So they compared species richness along the rainfall gradient. And if you compare apples with apples at the same point along the rainfall gradient, then there's nothing in it between mammal richness in forests and savannas, nor is there really any much difference in birds. It's only really in the vascular plants that you find a clear difference, with fewer vascular plants in the grassy biomes compared to the closed squares, which are forests. Yet another test of diversity is to look at the global biodiversity hotspots of the world and to ask how many of those are any of those non-forests. Or do you have to be a forest to be a hotspot with more than 1,500 endemic species and severely threatened? Well, it turns out that at least seven of the global biodiversity hotspots out of around 30 plus are open, non-forested sites. They include the Mediterranean regions of the world, and they include the Sahara Karoo, the arid areas of the world. And they contribute to the richness of at least six more biodiversity hotspots of the world, where both open and closed vegetation contributes to the richness. So, have another look. Remove your bias that forests are the only place where it's worth going to look at biodiversity. I think the most interesting tests, which are old, they've been going on for a long time, is whether tree planting increases diversity. And the most studies are linked to bird diversity. So this is one that I found in Argentina. There's a national park on this side. If you visit it and you're not used to fire, you might consider this degraded and burnt and horrible. Whereas this, with these beautiful trees, is a perfect habitat for biodiversity. Well, what the trend shows that in this study was, as you added more and more trees, the richness declined successively of birds, with the least birds in this mature eucalypt forest, which is this stuff, and the most in this stuff. Surprise, surprise, but a very common result. Here's another one. Another example, this is from South Africa. It's an old study, but we've known this a long time. And what you find here are these grasslands. And there are nature forests growing in these grasslands, which has led to the belief that the grasslands must have been derived from deforestation, which we now know is quite wrong. But it's also perfect habitat for planting trees for commercial afforestation. Here's a planted forest. There's another planted forest. There's some planted forests. And the question is, what do these plantations do for the bird species on a landscape scale? If you take a quarter degree square out of this, and some portion of that is planted up with trees, does it influence the diversity? So these grasslands are rich in grassland endemic species, with at least 25 species of conservation concern in this particular area, and 10 species that are globally threatened worldwide, and they're entirely restricted to grasslands. This is their home. And that in itself tells you these grasslands must be ancient if you have endemic grassland habitat species. And this is what happens when you start putting in plantations. These are the grassland specialist species, the globally threatened ones, and they just get out of there. And by between 60 and 80% plantation coverage, the birds, the grassland specialist birds, disappear. They've gone. If you contrast that with the forest birds, of which there are none of conservation concern because they're all generalists, then you see that they're absent or they're lacking when there's no forest cover, but they quickly reach an asymptote. So small patches of afforestation are suitable to capture basically all the forest and woodland birds. So a very striking contrast here, where planting trees severely threatens grassland birds and reduces the total diversity of birds in South Africa. So does this mean the myth is busted? Well, I don't know. I don't think we should really be talking in terms of forests versus open systems. I think it's much better to consider the importance of maintaining open forested habitats like this magnificent forest in Gabon and the open habitats. This is the way you have to look at diversity here. Here you're craning your neck up. Here you've got to lie on the ground to see what's going on. This is Campos Rupestre in Brazil, recently recognized as one of the major biodiversity hotspots in Brazil, which is an extraordinarily biodiverse country anyway, crammed with all kinds of fascinating plants and animals now coming out in this very hot vegetation. And of course, the open habitats in Africa are one of our key economic advantages. all these wonderful animals that live in the world of grass. Grass is their home. The forests have an entirely different biota, which also needs to be cared for, but we can't afford to lose either of them. So I'm sure that you'd be able to add some more myths if you thought about it. The biggest myth of the lot is that trees and forests are intrinsically the pinnacles of nature's creations. And that arising from that, humans have a natural affinity for trees and want to plant them. I've seen this written on paper. Not that Homo sapiens left the forest and got out into the savannas to try and get a bit of sun on their backs. The myth that planting trees is a simple, direct way that I, as a human being, can make a difference to the future of the planet and by helping to decarbonize the world. And there are other myths, but these are two dangerous myths. You know, somebody at the conference on nature-based solutions last week showed us this incredible sign from Shell, you know, and make a change, drive carbon neutral, you buy your petrol here, and we'll plant a tree to balance out what you've done. I don't know. What can I say? What should the message be? Buy your petrol here, and we'll make sure that we put in infrastructure in Africa that is going to be entirely independent of fossil fuels. Buy your petrol here, and we're working really hard to change our business so that we never sell petrol or fossil-based fuels again. What do we say? And then this idea that trees and forests are the pinnacles of nature's creation. I believe this came up in UK elections, unbelievably, with all parties supporting the planting of trees. But do all citizens support planting trees? Goodbye to your moorlands, goodbye to the heathlands. The downs, let's plant them all up with trees. Bye-bye the grasslands. Cheerio the ancient meadows. How can you do this? It's a form of environmental vandalism. So I wonder, what is the source of the forest myth? And I don't have the research skills to explore such questions. But I do wonder, is this fetish for forests a peculiarly European cultural obsession? Or is it more widespread than that? And given our history over the last few centuries, has that culture been foisted on the rest of the world so that we now suffer from this particular myth? And just to counter the myth, we have people who love open country. When I see these magnificent hills in the Drakensberg, my whole soul and heart lifts, and it's expressed beautifully by Alan Payton, saying these hills are grass covered and rolling, and they are lovely beyond any singing of it. That's how so many South Africans feel about seeing a landscape of grass, magnificent and open, with views to as far as the eye can see, rather than blocked out by a bloody tree in the way. And here's a picture of Scotland. And I like this little quote. Does he like the moor? Said Colin. How can he, when it's such a great, bare, dreary place? It's the most beautiful place, protested Mary. Thousands of lovely things grow on it, and there are thousands of little creatures. It's their world. And that's a quote from The Secret Garden, written in England and a favorite children's book. So yeah, which myth? So to conclude, I strongly believe we should protect forests where they're old and where we can. But we must be careful not to follow the mythology that because they are forests, they're intrinsically ancient. And as Fairhead and Leach showed, this is not to be taken for granted. I believe we should be planting trees for commercial forestry, for timber, for the many uses of timber. We should be planting trees for beauty and shade. My garden has a whole lot of trees, which we enjoy. But where are the forest myths leading us? We should not plant trees, in my view, when they will destroy the sun-loving plants and animals of the world. Beware, this mad rush to cover the world with trees could cause the biggest slide to extinction, the human cause that we've ever seen. We should not plant trees where they lull us into inaction over carbon emissions. You know, buy petrol, don't worry, we'll plant a tree, and it doesn't matter if you use another bit of oil into the atmosphere. We should not plant trees where we pass off the problem of land cover change to tropical countries. You know, we're going to come and plant trees in Cameroon or Gabon or Swaziland. And if you've lost out for land for agriculture, for crops, for your livestock, well, that's tough. You're saving the world. Shouldn't be doing that. We should not ignore the massive threats of carbon loss from peat loss and the loss of the permafrost in the cold north. There should be massive research and applied ecological efforts to understand under what circumstances you can maintain that carbon, lock it up, and keep it under permafrost as long as you possibly can. We should be evaluating our myths. And if you want to find out more about the non-forest ecosystems, here's a book that Yadvinda mentioned in my introduction. And then I like this quote, yet another one, from Ansel Adams. I cannot think of a more tasteless undertaking than to plant trees in a naturally treeless area and to impose an interpretation of natural beauty on a great landscape that is charged with beauty and wonder and the excellence of eternity. How about that in praise of non-trees? Thank you very much.
Thank you, William. Terrific. Both very powerful, provocative, and poetic at times as well. Thank you for your talk. I'd now like to open up to the audience for questions. And what I suggest is just to curate it, if you pop in that you'd like to ask a question, you don't have to detail the question substantially, but into the chat box, it'll help me manage and curate those. But while we're waiting for perhaps a few questions to pop into the chat box, I'll kick off with one. And this is just on the details of the water metric. And I think you made a compelling case of we have to consider the scale of the landscape. We have to consider the demand for water that trees employ, particularly in arid landscapes. But I do notice that the metric we think about is runoff, which is probably appropriate as a utilitarian metric in arid landscapes where that runoff is providing water to a settlement, etc. But maybe there are other contexts where actual rainfall is a more useful metric. So if you think of subsistence agriculture in a landscape, it's not so much water, how much water there is in the river that is a metric, but how much water is falling from the sky onto that farm, for example. So it's really just a questioning in what context is runoff the best sort of metric of the water benefits of a forest, and whether other metrics are more appropriate in some contexts.
Yeah, I thought a bit about that, but you'd have to design a pretty strange landscape to try and use the forest to create more rain, and that rain to then allow to change the climate into a more moister climate for crops. So how do you get the crops and the forest to co-occur in the landscape, and where the crops benefit from the forest, but there are no there are no trees growing where the crops are? But yes, that's I couldn't imagine the kind of landscape where you could get the benefits of the supply side rain from forests, but also the benefits to agriculture. But I agree, what is the metric? What is the appropriate metric? And we certainly have areas in South Africa that I'd be very keen to try and see whether there's been any recorded change in rainfall with the tree planting. The trouble is to try and find a control on a big enough scale.
Okay, thank you. We've got a few questions coming in, so I'll look at those. So Ollie has a question. Ollie, would you like to switch on your camera and present your question? Maybe William, if you stop sharing your screen, it might be easier to, we can refer back to it if people need to see a slide. Ollie, are you there? Okay, so I think I need to actually change the security. Okay, go ahead.
Yeah. Okay, cool. Can you hear me now?
Yeah, that's good. Yeah.
Yeah, thanks for that. There was, you know, loads of provocative things in there and loads of thought-provoking things. Yeah, I have kind of two separate things. One is a question and one is a point that I think I want to dig into. So the question part, I take the overwhelming weight of evidence that you showed us about afforestation and runoff rates and drought and the way that that's been used as a kind of policy tool, and actually it might not deliver what it promises. But I just wanted to throw in another angle in there, which complicates it, and wonder if you've got any evidence on that, which is to say, of course, you know, high runoff rates and full streams don't necessarily mean a good water supply, because if you've got a very highly seasonal environment, and I'm thinking of places where I work with a rainy season, a dry season, if it rains and all the water tips straight off, you know, this kind of topography, then you're left with a season of very bad water supply. And there's a lot of argument to say that, you know, higher levels of afforestation slow down the runoff rate, and therefore you get a more even water supply and you don't get the peak droughts. And I was wondering, has the research been done on that in the context that you're talking about, and is it conclusive in either direction there? So that's one question. The other one is on a slightly different thing. Can I?
Fire away both of them.
Okay. So the second one is to go to your slide on biodiversity in the species graphs. If we can flip back to that, because if you're able, I'm not sure if we can see that on the screen again or whether that will be too complicated, but I think looking at the scales there, it wasn't up for long enough for me to capture it, but I thought, and correct me if I'm wrong, because you've got, you know, you take your point about vertebrate diversity, but the vascular plant diversity, and invertebrates aren't on it, and that would be, you know, a really interesting area to know about. Mm. But in vascular plants, the species count is in thousands, and in vertebrates, it's in hundreds. And so that variety of vascular plants, I mean, if we are boiling biodiversity down to just species counting, that biodiversity of vascular plants is massively more than the biodiversity that there isn't in terms of vertebrate animal life. So those are the two questions.
Hmm. Well, on the first one, on the water issue, that work certainly been done in the catchment experiments in South Africa, and the base flow through the dry season is far better from our grasslands or shrubland catchments than from the forests. Mm. So the idea that the trees act as a sponge and so on, which is very prominent and has been for years, is just not correct.
Okay.
I don't know in all the hundreds of other catchment experiments around the world. And the other point that I didn't have time to mention is that in Britain, I know that people want to plant trees to reduce flooding. And I don't know anything about that. In the British context of huge amounts of rain, most of the time, these hydrological results can be quite different from those parts of the world where we have seasonal drought, and that's one of our major problems. Mm-hmm. And on the second one, the diversity, that's a very interesting point. I hadn't picked it up. But I would say that the data going into those graphs, comparing the different tropical places, probably greatly underestimates the diversity of plants, because the small plants have not been well studied. So I see Giselda and Alessandra are hooked in here. They've been studying forbs in the Cerrado, for example. And it's an incredible diversity, which has been ignored until fairly recently. So these are first stabs at it. But then I suppose when it comes to policy, what are people interested in? do they only see trees or do they also see the forbs? And I would very much like to see more effort to look at things in a different way, to get on your hands and knees and start crawling around. And you'll be amazed at what you start picking up. I hope that sort of partly answers you.
Yeah, thank you. That's really interesting. Thanks.
Thank you. There's a few more questions. A couple of things I should point out. Firstly, we are recording both the talk and this Q&A session. So if any of you are hesitant about being recorded and will be disseminated on YouTube later, just be aware of that. I will post it onto YouTube probably by tomorrow, so feel free to share it. We'll tweet about it when we do that. I think when you introduce the question, it's quite nice to have such a diverse audience here. It's nice to say where you're calling in from as well, and get a sense of the diversity of the audience. So the next question is from Christian Frankenberg.
Let me just start my video. Hi, this is Christian Frankenberg from Caltech in Pasadena, California. But I'm originally from Europe and got this invite here via Twitter. That's how I found it. Just a few comments from me, who's more like a person coming from the atmospheric science community and a little bit on the global climate modeling part, where I would disagree a little bit with the recycling event, because for the water recycling part, we know from modeling and measurements of water isotopes, especially like in the Amazon, that there's definitely a heavy recycling of water in the Amazon, because we don't see any kind of HDO depletions from the oceans towards kind of the center of the Amazon. But I think this is also interesting because there have been climate models that basically where you can cut down all the trees in climate models and see what the effect is on the global climate. Ironically, if you cut down all the northern hemispheric trees, it will actually get cooler because forests are typically really dark. And the effect of increase in CO2 is more than counterbalanced by the decrease in surface albedo, by the increase in surface albedo if you cut down trees. The only difference being the Amazon, because you decrease cloud cover and thereby decrease the albedo if you cut down the Amazon. So this is just an aside. And maybe this speaks to a little bit the stovepiping of disciplines, because I was very curious about your statement, why is there this obsession with the forest in the tropics? It's actually the other way around in kind of more the climate and atmospheric community where everyone is obsessed with permafrost.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering what your take is on that. How do we bridge this? Because it seems to be there's different communities working in kind of climate change and they have different objectives. Some communities are louder than others, but how do we have a consistent voice that can actually be heard stronger and is as objective as possible?
Well, in preparing for this talk, I covered a lot of ground very quickly, and each of these myths, so-called myths, could take quite a lot of time to fully go into. But what impressed me was how very difficult it is to get a clear message from this, from the scientific literature. It's so broad, it's so productive, it's so vast. How can we try and communicate with the public? If you say, well, go and look at the literature, they would sink. I think most of us would sink if we put a step outside into somebody else's literature. I think the idea of myth busting is quite a fun one. In trying to compress it and to say, well, here are the issues. But really, it's a matter of how we communicate to policymakers and to the public, to people who are actually voting in an election to plant more trees. I know the albedo arguments, and I find them absolutely fascinating. And it's very nice to hear that the atmospheric community is concentrating on the north. I hope that will lead to useful action.
Well, thanks. We have our own myth when it comes to like exaggerating methane release from permafrost melting and things like this. So I think that's the only thing where we sometimes maybe have to be careful. If people state like if you plant trees, then everything will be fine. It's equally saying that if the permafrost melts, methane will go out and then all hell breaks loose. So it's kind of this balance between being loud enough to be heard and too loud to be kind of saying things that in the end will not be true and then no one will trust us anymore.
Yeah, Yeah, and we don't want to cast people into despair.
Sure. Thank you. And we have a question from Robin Chasden.
Great. Thanks. I really enjoyed your presentation, William. Lots of important points. I'm thinking about this from more of like a practical perspective, and the fact that you don't often see a complete spatial separation between where there are forests or clumps of trees and where there's grassland. I've been in many, many parts of the world where there's in natural landscapes, there's a complete mosaic of woody patches, forest patches, and grass-dominated patches. And my question is how to view these as in sort of a management issue. Should, rather than seeing it as the forest versus the grasslands and seeing these areas as their own type of ecosystem where you've got contributions of both, how do we then deal with issues of degradation and management, restoration and conservation by viewing these as mosaic units where, you know, obviously the trees may not regenerate if they're burned, but the grassland requires fires to regenerate.
Yeah. I think some of these mixtures where you're not quite sure whether you're in a savanna or a forest are the consequence of decades of fire suppression. And this seems particularly true in South America, in Brazil, for example, where what they call Cerro Dão, from what I can understand, is actually savanna being invaded by forest trees over long periods of time. And I think the same is true of India, where they've also had a very strong background of fire suppression. So I think the boundaries have to be clarified. Sometimes it's an edaphic boundary, it's a soil boundary, and then it's clear cut. But when it is literally a fire boundary, then there has to be some damage to trees, or those grasslands will be swallowed up. And the problem is that fire has a minimum area requirement. And indeed, as far as we can tell, although a lot more work needs to be done, the grass and endemic species have a high area requirement relative to a forest. I'm thinking of birds here. So these are interesting and important questions. And from my own personal experience, which is, you know, in a South African context, the biggest problem is maintaining the grasslands and applying the management to them. The forests tend to look after themselves, and under normal conditions, the boundaries are maintained. If people start logging within a forest and bring fire into a forest far from the natural forest margins, then we're really in trouble. And that's what we've seen, I think, in a lot of the Amazon. But it would be really good to start laying out clearly what the framework should be for trying to manage landscapes for both, for the forest and the open country. So thanks for bringing that up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Thank you, Robin. And a similar theme of question, I'm filtering through, there's quite a few questions here. A question from Fernando Silveira. Fernando, are you there?
Hi, William.
Okay, great.
I'm the dark here because I'm a little baby.
No.
Really, in many cases, you compare the biodiversity.
So you're very quiet, Fernando. We can't quite hear you. Maybe, if you don't mind, I'll just read out your question, maybe, Fernando, and then William can answer it from there.
Just by the
way. Okay. So Fernando asks that you've shown a contrast between grasslands and monocultures. And advocates of FLR would say that that's sort of a slightly false contrast, that actually it's biodiverse forests and grasslands that should be contrasted. But how would you respond to that?
The very interesting thing, at least for birds, is that they tend to respond to vegetation structure more than vegetation composition. So I would say that actually, whether it's a monoculture or many species, unless those additional species add different structural components, the results will be very similar. And you're welcome to test that argument.
Okay.
But it is remarkable to me that you know the birds don't seem to discriminate between species, even when they're food species like fruits. It's the structure that counts.
Okay, thank you. There's a question from Trevor on oxygenation. Trevor, are you there? I think we might have lost Trevor. Scrolling through. There's a comment from Shyam Patyal. I don't know whether Shyam, whether you want to share your comment. And I think I would know William's response to that. That's an observation. Shyam, are you there? The observation that Shyam was making was that different Indian state forest departments are competing with each other to do large-scale forest plantation during every monsoon season. So similarly, there is this push to a forest. And what is your take on that? I think we know the answer to that, but you may want to comment on that observation.
Well, I think it's very important in South Asia and Southeast Asia, and indeed in all over the place, for people to start recognizing the value of the non-forests and for people to start arguing for them. I mean, this is the point of giving this talk, which is excruciatingly agonizing for me to enter into the world of Zoom like this. But I think it's absolutely critical that we stop this mad obsession with afforestation. I really am concerned about the legacy we're going to have and it's all, people are saying we've got to do it now, immediately, straight away, because it takes so long for it to work. Well, really, that's crazy. Why not start immediately now reducing emissions in a massive way, which I know the UK and Europe are doing, but spread it around. Make sure that you really bring down those emissions fast. That's something that can be done fast. Planting forests is a very slow and uncertain way of trying to geoengineer the future of the planet.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I'll sort of interject here with a question, focus on the UK perspective. And as you probably know, William, in the UK, there's an interesting moment here. There is a surge of interest in planting trees. Some of it may be in monoculture, some of it may be in appropriate areas such as peatlands. But much of the attention is also focused on agricultural landscapes, this controversy about the upland regions such as Wales and the Lake District, which are sheep farming areas, and maybe reforesting those, but also some of the abandoned agricultural lands. And while it could be argued that while these important caveats coming in from people like you about hold on, let's be careful about a rush to trees, which I think is highly appropriate, there's a danger also in dissipating this potential tipping point in thinking about, say, rural landscapes where there could be more trees in that landscape and there should be more trees in those landscapes in whatever form. So is there a slight danger of being perhaps a little bit too enthusiastic and saying, oh, don't get overexcited by trees, just when the wider community is getting interested in the landscape restoration for the first time?
What I see is that interest from the public is being abused. You know, it's by people who are making a quick buck out of the tree planting business. And then, well, who's going to maintain it? If it's really going to make a difference, it's got to be there for centuries. you know, and it's going to change the country, the rural economy, the rural lives, the way people live. I've been very interested to hear what's happened in Ireland, where these, under EU legislation, they've been planting in plantations of spruce and so on, and how it's completely separated people from each other. So the neighbors can no longer see each other, and how they're concerned about the loss of their parts of nature that depend on open habitat. And they're being ignored. They're being overwhelmed because of these big, massive, you know, European Union policies and programs. So I'm rooting for the little guys to wave the flag and to try and stop this, to put some bits of grit into these big machines and stop them grinding on before it's too late and we screw everything up again. Anyway, sorry. But yes, I was surprised that a group in Scotland who support ancient woodlands invited me to write an article on the problems of tree planting in the moorlands and the heathlands. So I feel an affinity for ancient woodland people who celebrate these beautiful trees in the British landscape, these ancient oaks or magnificent lime trees. The forests, Wytham Woods outside Oxford, beautiful places to walk and to appreciate. But why should that then turn into a mass of monocultures of pines and firs, you know? And that is what's actually happening on the ground. The public needs to be able to make the distinction.
Thank you. Okay, we'll take a few more questions. One from Kogi on South Africa. Are you there still?
Yes. Okay. Hi, William. Thank you for the interesting talk. I just find that municipalities often get funding for tree planting and they see this as a cash cow. What are your suggestions for us to change the way they think about tree planting? Thank you.
That's a wonderful comment. That is the truth, is the money that's going into the bond challenge, for example, it's millions of dollars. It's nothing in comparison to the problem that is faced. But for Africa, it's a lot of money. And who's benefiting from that money? I don't know. So I think we should try and close the tap at source and stop the whole tree planting program and make it a good one, you know, so that it's not huge amounts of dollars suddenly appearing if you plant 1,000 hectares of trees here or there or the other place. I don't know. I'm very aware of how these funding programs can get twisted and bent and the money ending up in the wrong place. How do you stop that happening? Oh, that's an issue of governance, which is right outside my my competencies. So I'll try and stop it at source. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. And a question from Mohamed Armani.
Yeah. Hi, William. Thanks very much for the talk. It was really inspiring. I was actually looking at this a while ago because I realized that around 2010 in Ghana, they had this money coming from the HIPIC fund, and what they did for the first time in Ghana was to make plantations from right up from the tropical forest area all the way to the northern part of Ghana, which is savannah. And immediately in 2012, they did some assessment of this plantation, initial assessment. So basically, since I came back here, I've been interested in following up on that to check what exactly we know about that. But then I decided to look into the literature a little bit. And I was surprised because in West Africa, we have planted plantations for a very long time, but I have so far not been able to find a single study that has actually looked at this plantation establishment, their impact across the different biomes, looking at different indicators. For example, you will find a study that looks at carbon sequestration, you will find a study that probably look at best diversity, but we have never done any multiple ecological impact across the whole gradient before. And it appears to me the literature that you brought also seems to suggest that. So we really don't really know the exact impact when we have these plantations, even though they have been there for quite a long time. Is my sense right in this direction?
Those are very interesting comments. I think it'll be fascinating to look. I mean, Ghana is particularly interesting because of that that massive gradient on the coast inland. I did find a paper recently, but it's on the carbon sequestration side of things. And it was showing that the plantations of there were three or four species, and the carbon sequestration at least there was excellent. So sometimes plantations are, usually they're a disaster for carbon, but in Ghana there are some success stories. But you're quite right, to look at the thing holistically, there's nothing, and it really needs to be done. And what happens with fires, you know, when these fires start burning through those plantations, the grasslands burn every year. Someday those plantations are all going to go up in smoke, and then who's going to plant them again? Who's going to fight the fires? How good are the Europeans at fighting fires? The Americans, the Australians, they're really useless. So what's going to be like in Africa, where suddenly we have huge eucalypt plantations, we've got to run around and try and put fires out? These are questions that are not being properly explored. Anyway, thanks. Thanks. Nice to hear you, see you in your comments.
Thank you, Mohamed. Okay, a question from Sue.
Yeah, William, I was just curious, when I asked the Bonn folk at the UNCCD meeting, had they done an assessment on the water impact of the tree planting? The comment I got back was what they're really only interested in is improving the productivity of the landscape. And by my take, way I see them looking at that is sort of through remote sensing and NDVI. And yeah, I was just wondering on what you feel as productivity being a metric of restoration in African flammable ecosystems.
And this is in the context of the Great Green Wall, is that it?
Yes, correct.
Yeah, well, you finger the tropics because it's warm and trees grow fast is the idea. And then so you can harvest them. And the models say that you're going to harvest them every 10 years, which I think is optimistic. And then you do something with them, we don't know what. And then you plant them again, and you do something with them, we don't know what. And you plant them again, and you do something with them, and you plant them again. What that does for land use, for people on the ground, for water, for people who might need grass for their livestock or for anything else, has not been adequately explored. So I think the Bonn people are trying to move very fast on a massive change to landscapes where they are active. And we need to be very careful that they do it properly. I think there are developments in where you can do it properly. I think there's some studies where people are looking at interventions where you could plant trees where there were trees before and where you're most likely to accumulate lots of carbon, and where any gain there might have been from removing trees for water is like a cheat, if you like. So, but you know, if you're setting targets in terms of billions of trees or millions of hectares rather than in terms of 20% of the suitable area, and now it's 30% of the suitable area, now it's 60% of the suitable area, that's a very different way of setting targets. And I think, unfortunately, the tree planting community has expressed their progress in terms of area and numbers, and that's very dangerous.
Thank you. Okay, a question from Tricia.
Hi, William. Sorry, I'm typing another question, so I got a little confused and don't remember what I asked you. But according to you, what is the next big or next a few big next questions the science community has to answer when it comes to research and analysis into savannas and grasslands in countries like India, where the narrative is mostly forest-centric.
Well, you know, there's it's going to remove right away from the aim of this talk, but I think the thing that would be really fun to do would be to start exploring contrasting traits in forest and savannas, things that are built around regular fires or heavy herbivory, and things that are not. And those contrasts are really interesting. And then there's surprisingly few studies of biodiversity going from grassy systems to closed forest systems. What changes and in what ways? People tend to be either working in forests or in the open habitats, but the comparisons would be really fascinating. But that's a biologist speaking, not a global geoengineer.
Thank you.
Trisha, as you were typing your second question, do you want to just, as you have the floor, do you want to just give it?
Sure. From the perspective of livelihoods, income generation, and employment, what do you think would win, forests or savannas and grasslands?
It depends a bit where you are. In part of the European mythology, I didn't want to raise it because I know it's controversial, is meat. You know, stop eating meat because animals contribute so much to changes in the atmosphere which are harmful. But Africa, many cultures are so deeply intertwined with livestock, with cattle. You can't get yourself a wife unless you have some link with cattle in this part of the world. So here, there's no question that livelihoods are strongly bound to grass. The same is true of Madagascar, also a cattle keeping culture. But it varies, depends where you are, and I wouldn't like to make a blanket statement. And I carefully avoided any mythology about animals.
Thank you.
Okay, Robert Skelton, you had a question? Well, I don't forget to leave. Robert was asking about whether E.O. Wilson's Half Earth proposal is something that could capture some of your desire to sort of recognize and protect open systems, and whether you had any thoughts on this. And what would be your dream bond challenge be? Bond challenge.
I like that idea of half the world. And I picked it up. I didn't pick it up by E.O. Wilson, but I'm not as widely read as I should be. But I have picked it up from Dinnerstein and others, and I think it's a good idea. I just really I'm concerned that we're going to let the creatures of the world dribble through our fingers without recognizing it as we become more urban, more divorced from things. I worry that all the young biologists are seeing the world through computer screens, and I just hope that they do get hot and sweaty and leak a little bit of blood when they fall into a thorn bush, because that is where you learn so much, and that is the direct connection that we have and need to maintain with nature.
Thank you. Poetic words. Graham Jewett, you had an observation or a comment. I don't know whether you want to share that, if you're able to.
I'll try. I ended up typing it into the chat box. I just wanted to flag one of the early, one of the Mythbusters was Ian Calder, who's a very well-known British hydrologist. And he did quite a lot of work on water and trees, and including in temperate climates. So the importance of deciduous versus non-deciduous trees and things like that, and the impact on groundwater recharge. he did a lot of work on. And his revision of his Blue Revolution book, which was largely written in response to all these myths, has a chapter called Policies, Power and Perversity, which deals with the myths and environmental policy. So he picked this up some time ago. Unfortunately, he died probably, must be 10 years ago now. And maybe just one other comment while I'm online, there's in the biofuels rush about 10 years ago, there was also this push to plant biofuels all over the tropics of Africa. And Prof. Saif Madoff at Sokoine University of Agriculture called it climate colonialism, because the money was coming from the north and the investments in the south.
Thanks. I was aware of Ian Caller's work in the Zambezi catchment, and it was brilliantly elegant. And I thought if somebody could think that broadly over a river system, that's a real challenge for ecologists as well. So thanks very much for reminding me of him.
Okay, thank you. Okay, I think we'll wrap up there on all the questions. So thank you, William. That was as I knew it would be, it was a thought-provoking talk, covering a broad range of issues, but provocative in places, but also having you have an ability to condense diverse and complex issues into very clear, crisp, razor-sharp observations, and intersperse them with moments of passion and poetry as well. So that was a thoroughly enjoyable and thought-provoking presentation. So thank you for making the time to present to us all. So if everybody wants to, you can unmute your videos and microphones, and let's give William a round of applause. So thank you. Thank you.
How are you doing? Thanks very much. Thank you, Edward.
Okay, as I said, we'll put this onto YouTube by tomorrow morning, so feel free to share with your students and colleagues and others. We'll stick it out on Twitter.
Good.
Okay, thank you very much, and have a good evening, good weekend, everyone.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you much.
Lisa, very nice to see you.
It's lovely to see you, and I enjoyed your talk very much.
Oh, well, great.
Yeah, thanks, William. It was great.
Good. Cheers, Nikki. Thanks. I'll fix you one day for setting this thing up. Okay. Bye.
Yes.